Hello, hello. We are in a new webinar room. It looks like many of you are joining us. I can see you on the chat. I'm just, whoops. Oh shoot. I'm going to close the old webinar room. I just sent a new link to everyone who was registered via email. Oh no, it looks frozen. Type
Really?
in. Nope, it came back. So it looks like we have 60 attendees in the room. And please type into the chat. Let us know what you're seeing, if you're seeing both me and Phyllis, and if you're hearing us. This is our first time using, I suppose, a new feature with the webinar platform since the one that we are used to using didn't work. And we appreciate your flexibility coming on. Okay, so you see both of us. Beautiful. Thank
Oh,
you. Yeah, phew. So, okay. That was weird. But here we are. I'm just going to confirm that the email went out to everyone. Great. It looks like it did. Okay. So, welcome to this episode of Global Reiki Webinars. I'm Rachel Goldberg, and I'm here with Phyllis Furumoto, who is the lineage bearer and grandmaster of Usui Shiki Ryoho, which is the lineage of Reiki that most people around the world simply refer to as Reiki. And today we are talking about first degree. First degree is all you need is the title of this webinar. We're gonna just get into it. And I'll say that we have a number of programs and different opportunities coming up for you to engage with as a member of the Global Reiki community. And due to the technical issues today, I'm not going to share those links online right now, but everyone who is registered for this webinar will get a link to all of our programs coming up in the mail or in your email. And I'll also be posting them all in our Facebook group. So if you are joining us live or perhaps watching the replay of this webinar on YouTube and you don't know about our community Facebook page, it's simply called Global Reiki Webinars. And so just in the search on top of your Facebook page, type in Global Reiki Webinars and you can request to join and come in and join the discussion that happens online 24/7. People from the Global Reiki community bringing up reflections from these live broadcasts, as well as their own thoughts and insights as they walk with Reiki throughout their lives. I'll also say before I turn it over to Phyllis for the program, that all of our opportunities, we have two opportunities in February coming up that we'll say a little bit more about at the end of this webinar. But I'll just say the first one is a paid program that we call Healing Practice to Professional Practice, which is a two-day weekend intensive with Phyllis online and myself. And it's something that we ran in 2016. It's a wonderful program, and we'll be opening registration later today for you if you'd like to participate in that, coming up February 25th and 26th. The other opportunity is one called Local Communities to Global Community, and it's a unique online intensive experience. Phyllis will be with a local community in San Francisco practicing in person, and we, of course, are creating an opportunity for you to register to join us virtually for that program. But in our online intensive in the past, there's been an opportunity for you to register as an individual. But for local communities, global community, we're actually creating an opportunity for you to register as a local community organizer. So rather than registering as an individual, you would register as a community organizer with a higher registration fee, but you would be able to invite as many people as you want from your local community to come join you and organize an experience either before or after the virtual sessions with Phyllis and the San Francisco community, or even in between the two sessions of that day, February 18th. So look out for more information about that in your emails and in the Facebook page. And of course, we also have our in-person Global Reiki community gathering that we're doing for the very first time this June. And you'll have some information about that later on. Whew, that was a lot of announcements, a lot more than we tend to have on these. And I appreciate you sticking with us. It looks like we now have almost as many attendees as we had in the previous webinar room, which is great. And without further ado, I'm going to stop talking and turn it over to Phyllis.
Hello. Excuse me, I have a bit of congestion. Let me think. I'm just testing my sound to see if I should get my headphone, but I think I'm okay. All right, everyone, let's take a moment to connect with each other, connect with our Reiki, of course, and hands on. Thank you. Thank you so much for joining us today. I was just thinking about global community when I really started to practice and teach in 1980. We talked about the global community, and then it was a few people here and there, and people who had been to Hawaii, met Hawaii Otakata, and then traveled or went back home, wherever they lived in the world. And now, of course, Reiki has traveled itself to, well, I would say all the countries in the world, and that with the help of our internet, we are becoming able to realize that, to actually have it be a physical experience, which is what happens here. So incredible. And this San Francisco gig February the 18th on a Saturday is our first opportunity to take a group of people who will be live in San Francisco. We're going to start meeting at 9:30 in the morning and go until 5, but the webinar itself will end at 3:30. And what we're going to do between 3:30 and 5 is to have a conversation about the experience and then to do some hands-on Reiki with each other. And I hope that you will be able to, in your own time frame, maybe have people over, have Reiki treatments and lunch before we start, and then attend the webinar afterwards. Just to have a community experience, but also to be able to join groups of people as well as individuals. So it'll be a bit of a mix, and a bit of mix of virtual and real time. And so it's very, very exciting, and we'll see how this experience measures up to the experience that we have here, where I have been so surprised at the contact that I have felt with each of you. And of course, some of you show up in our chat box every webinar, or most every webinars. And so we're getting to know you. I'm getting to know you through the questions that you ask. It's just really amazing. And if somebody had told me that this would be happening even 10 years ago, I would have said, no way would I make friends with my computer in this way. But it's great. Thank you for being a part of this. And taking us back to 1980 and in the 1970s, when I would sit in on my classes, on the classes with Hawaii Takata and her talks to people about Reiki, she would always say, first degree is all you need. And in my mind, I would say, well, why do you teach second degree then? And it's a great question, because it meant that I really didn't know what Reiki was. And I didn't understand what the promise of Reiki was at that time. So then, after the 1980s and into the 1990s, there were all these different forms of practice that were developed through other masters and so on. And then I wondered, well, what does it mean, first degree is all you need? And is it true for other forms of practice? Well, in truth, I can't tell you whether it is or not, but I believe in general that the first degree or the first level gives you your conscious connection to the energy Reiki. And this energy is described through the translation of the word Reiki, universal life energy. And this is the energy that is giving life to everything that we know. And of course, as we all probably know, even things that seem inanimate, like rocks and mountains and so on, are really moving. Their molecules are moving inside these rocks, and they are alive and they are living. And for those who are sensitive, you can hold the rock and actually feel this. To the point where, of course, people in Hawaii say never to take any rock or pebble from Hawaii, because they belong to Pele, who is the goddess of fire and has created this rock, and that she will come and claim the rock wherever you take it. So just remember that if you go to Hawaii. I'm really, it's really exciting to see that my idea of what's alive has changed from 1980 to now, where I see everything that is living and that we all have interconnection. So this phrase, first degree is all you need, was like this opening of a puzzle. And in the first years that I practiced Reiki, it was like finding little pieces of the puzzle that I put together and finally have an understanding of what she might have meant. I say might have because I don't really know for sure, but this is how I see it at this moment. If I take Reiki and see it as a method to heal headaches, then it would seem appropriate in my own Western thinking to say, well, if I have second degree, then I can heal Reiki, I can heal headaches faster and better because it's the second level. But that's not actually my experience. And it's not my experience that as a master, my treatments are more powerful than others. It may be, there are so many factors involved in receiving a treatment. Like it may be that the person who is receiving the treatment gives me more credit and is able to be more vulnerable and to be more open. And so their receptivity is easier. We don't know. Or maybe it's just a connection that we might have. Just that in our world where we think that levels are about, you know, like good, better, best, that's not been my experience in Reiki at all. I've had fabulous treatments from people who just were initiated in Reiki. And I've had Reiki treatments from masters where I think, maybe I'm not so open today. And we don't know why our physical response is different from one treatment to another. So then what does it really mean, Reiki is all you need? Let's start with the questions, because they really lead us into a discovery about this phrase. And through the question, and
thank you all,
thank
for,
you
all
asking
for asking
your questions.
Were great.
They were great
time,
as time, well.
As well.
So, Rachel, are you ready to go to the questions, or are you still working with the technical part of it?
I've got the questions.
Okay, cool.
And
I'm just going to turn off my screen for a moment and my sound because I need to. Yeah, I need to. And I'll be back to answer the question.
Okay. Great. So feeling a good breath, seeing that so many of you have your technology working and that we do as well. That was really interesting and fun experience for all of us to have together. I've got the first question. There's Phyllis. The first question from Anne Selma, who wrote, I am new to Reiki. What exactly is first degree and why is it all you need?
Perfect first question, right? In my practice, there are three levels of initiation. There's first degree, second degree, and master. The first degree, what I tell people is that it's your introduction to what might be possibly your spiritual path. This might not be your choice, and you may not develop it into your personal path, but it's there. And what I have to offer are these simple tools for you to get in touch and create a relationship with Reiki, universal life energy. So my job as a master is to give you the tools that you can take anywhere. And you don't ever have to talk to me again, but your practice can develop into this very rich connection with the energy of Reiki, with everyone around you, and it will change your life if you allow it to. So that's first degree. And when Hawaii Otakata said, first degree is all you need, it was, I believe, because the conscious connection and then the practice, which allows that connection to be embedded in our consciousness and in our daily lives, allows this to be a path more than an accomplishment, if that is understandable. And for me, this connection to the energy of Reiki is really all you need to change your life.
Great.
Yeah.
The next question comes from Jane, who wrote, "What is gained from level 2 and masters? I have only been attuned to level 1 and I have no interest in using Reiki professionally or attuning others. Thank you so much for the seminars and for this wonderful opportunity for spiritual teaching and discussion and all your hard work."
Thank you, Jane, for your acknowledgement. And that's another great next question. So when people come to me and they say, well, I want to take second degree or level 2, I say, well, why? And if I find out that they feel that first degree is not enough, then I say you'll have to practice first degree more. Because I believe that if you are taking second degree because you're lacking something, it's really not what we might call appropriate motivation. First degree, you practice and you are given hands-on treatment. You're given the a methodology to practice so that you don't feel so shy in introducing the hands-on treatment to people around you or maybe even people you don't know. In level 2, what happens is you are given as tools symbols. In my practice, there are 3 of them. And these symbols I describe as keys to a doorway. And it is going through that doorway daily, or as much as possible daily, that allows you to grow in yet another level of understanding and consciousness. So it's not about being better. It's about actually having more commitment to the practice, and it's about having more consciousness in different levels of your existence, in your state of being. So instead of being mostly on the physical level of treatment, you then have this choice of being on a physical level and non-physical level. I won't use all the non-physical terms that people use because it sometimes doesn't communicate well. But just to let you know that the non-physical part is as full of potential and without limit as the physical. And for masters, that is when people say, I want to commit my life to Reiki. And what this means for me is that in order to really commit your life to Reiki, there is another way of learning, and that is to teach. You know the old saying, we teach what we need to know. I found this totally true in Reiki. And it's a way for us as Reiki masters to also be able to grow with our own students, and our students become in some way our stimulus and our motivation to seek deeper understanding and learning from our practice and a way to deliver that that's useful. So if you don't have any need to further go on with your practice or to feel that you want to deepen and a commitment to the practice by taking up more time and monetary energy and so on, then first degree is all you need. And there are lots of people, especially in Hawaii, of course, who took Reiki from Hawaii Otakata, have practiced Reiki first degree for 50, 60 years, and they're fine. They have, unfortunately, many of them have passed on now, but 20 years ago, when a lot of research was being done, they were the people in nursing homes that were still able to move around, to have conversation, to treat their fellow neighbors in the nursing home with Reiki. And they were the ones that were alert. So it was an interesting process. And most of them had first degree. Thanks.
So I want to address a couple of the questions coming through on the chat. Smiles said, glad we can pause and not miss anything. Is there a way to stop and continue where we left off later? And my response to you, Smiles, is I don't know. But I, so far, this new platform that we're using right now seems great. And let us know what you find on the user end, because this is our first time in it. So please let us know so we can inform everyone else. And then William had a question in regard to what you were saying, Phyllis, which is...
Let me read it. Go ahead.
He said, I have people approaching me who say that they have had first degree from a master, but are not really sure about giving it or treating themselves. I'm not a master, but is it okay to show them the positions and to help give confidence in using their Reiki already granted?
Sorry, I thought I turned off my microphone, but it was my camera. Of course, it's fine to show them what you know. Just be careful not to get into too much teaching. You know, just it's kind of like somebody says, oh, how do you like transfer your photos from your, like, how do I send a photo from my phone, you know, to somebody in a message? And I can show them that, but I'm not going to go through a lot of explanation and teaching. So I think that's a really good feel boundary for you.
Okay.
Yeah. And, you know, the thing of it is that I have had students that I taught, and I know what I teach because my classes always have the same outline. And, you know, I've had students later on, years later, say, oh, I never learned the self-treatment. And I'm going, well, you didn't. So, sometimes when you're students, you take in what you need and what you can accept in the moment. So if you have a chance to revisit first degree classes again and again from the master that you were initiated by, do so, because they're always different, and you are always different every time you go. Yeah.
Great. The next question that we have come in from advance, or come in advance, is from Mouse, who wrote, I had been taught that first degree allows a person to work on self, plants, and animals, but not other people. That level two is required to be considered a Reiki practitioner. Would you speak to this, please? And thank you.
Well, Mouse, my answer is, the short one is yes and no. Okay, so I give you a little longer one. What can I say? So your word allows is interesting for me, because in the way that I teach first degree, I don't give allowance to anybody in the sense of permission. And, you know, when people leave the class, even on the first night, they often are so curious about what will happen that they will go home and treat a plant or treat themselves or treat their pet or treat their goldfish or treat, you know, a sick tree in their yard or whatever. And so it's not about allowing, it's about where Reiki draws you to go. So just to play with that word a little bit. Of course, first degree, you can, I often say first degree is for yourself and your family and your friends. So it means that you can treat other people. And usually it is people that are close to you. It usually is about people who you have daily contact with and other things like plants and animals. So in that, I don't know if that's a part of your teaching or not. I didn't quite get that. It wasn't clear. And then when you say that level two is required to be considered a Reiki practitioner, this came about because now in our whole, especially in America, in the United States, in our whole understanding of Reiki as a healing practice, it is considered that Reiki needs to be available in hospitals and clinics and hospices and so on. And I would call that more of a public practitioner or a professional practitioner if we get to that stage of professional practice, which I can we'll talk about in February. But, you know, there are people who, there's this one woman in Australia, she was a riot. I mean, her story is that she, you know, took first degree. She kind of was at the last minute in the class, and she was having a holiday in a beach resort somewhere. And when she went after her class, the first class, to the beach, she was lying beside a person, and they started chatting about why they were there and so on. And she said, oh, I just decided to take this Reiki class. And they go, oh, that sounds exciting. Tell me about it. So she did. And they said, oh, I'd love to try it. Can you treat me? And she did what she had been taught the first class. And they said, oh, I'm really interested. I want to continue this. So they met every day, and she, you know, gave it more and more treatment because she learned more to this woman, other woman. And by the end of her holiday there, which was 2 weeks, she had a list of Reiki clients. And they were people that she didn't know. They came from just people being drawn to her and being, you know, wanting to have Reiki. And she eventually moved on from that, went back home, started a Reiki practice, because obviously this was someplace that Reiki was taking her, and eventually, of course, became a master. And she teaches now all over the world and has for the last, I don't know, 20 some years. So for me, it's really about every person's path and how Reiki brings them to that path. It's not an allowance, as is for, I don't think in my mind first degree is only for people who want to just treat themselves. It's this whole level of commitment to the practice. She took second degree because eventually she just had this feeling in herself, not a reason, a feeling that said, you have to take second degree. And she goes, but I don't want to. I'm happy where I am, and I don't want to spend that money. And she took second degree because that was all she could think about. And the same thing for masters. And that's really how it mostly goes. So I know that there are lots of different forms of practice that intimate that this is required, or maybe even softer than that, more applicable to have if you want to be a Reiki a public practitioner, but you don't need it. You know, mm-hmm. It's not necessary. Personally, for me, if I were to open up a professional practice training program, which is one of my dreams, but maybe will never be realized. And I'm pretty sure it's not going to be in my lifetime anyway. That I would ask people who are second degree practitioners to join this program, not because they need second degree as a initiation level, but because it's a sign of their commitment as a student of Reiki and their work with Reiki in themselves and their own development. And I would still be open for exceptions. I wouldn't make it a rule. I would make it a guideline. Hmm. So that's for me. And I think that if you go back to your master and have a conversation about this, it would be interesting to see if there's some really reasoning or understanding with these guidelines, or if they are, if it comes from another philosophy of how Reiki works. So, thanks.
Great. So, a follow-up to that I see in the chat is Eugenia said, is it enough to have Reiki certification in order to be a public practitioner? And I think what Phyllis was saying is that you simply need to be attuned to Reiki, and if you're called that way. Phyllis, please respond in your own voice.
Sure. Let me just say that a Reiki certificate, and this is where I become really well, some people call me controlling, but for me, I really have a hard time with this phrase Reiki certificate, because if you have a certificate, it means that there's a certifying body behind that certificate that actually provides security for the client or the public in general, that they are going to maintain certain standards that certificate demands. And that's about professionalism. That's why I say that I don't think that we're ever going to have professional Reiki practitioners, because those certificates that of training programs that these people would come out of would be stood behind, like a university or and a university wouldn't be able to deliver a Reiki certificate. It would only be a training program for a certain, and this is in my mind right now, for a certain form. Like, I could only certify people in my form. I couldn't certify people who do Karuna Reiki or do Angel Reiki or do other kinds of Reiki. I can only do my own form because I don't know anything about them, the other people's Reiki. So personally, it's not about having a Reiki certificate. It's about being dedicated to having Reiki be your personal practice, to have the depth of understanding of how Reiki works on physical, mental, emotional, and spiritual levels of people, so that you can actually provide actual safety for your clients. And it is also a willingness to have boundaries and to have clear understanding of what you provide and what you're going to do. I really, if you have a question about this and are really interested, I would really recommend the weekend in February where we go through this. But on some level, Reiki can bring you to public practice, like Reiki did with this woman in Australia. And did she need a Reiki certificate? No, but she needed to have taken Reiki. So that's my response.
Great. Our next questions come from Smiles, and also I saw in the chat Louisa was asking about this same topic, which is self-treatment. The question that was submitted in advance is, when doing self-Reiki, is it okay to do only 3 to 4 minutes of each position daily if you don't have time for five, or is that basically not doing it?
Great.
Yeah.
I love this question because it gives me an opportunity to debunk a myth, I think, that's growing. Mm-hmm. You know, when you get to be a Reiki practitioner of some experience, you don't need to actually keep track of the amount of time you stay on one position because it's about a feeling inside. And Reiki and your relationship with the energy of Reiki. So I might start a treatment. I go through the hand positions. It may end up being an hour and 15 minute treatment, which is my usual treatment time. But I might spend 2 or 3 minutes on one position and 10 minutes on another position because that's what Reiki guides me to do. And one of the things that has happened over the last 15 years or so, especially since we have wonderful tools like little pyramids that chime every few minutes or whatever, we have kind of gotten to be a bit more dogmatic about the amount of time that needs to be for each treatment position. But, you know, one of the other little things that Hawaii Otakata would say is, a little bit of Reiki is better than no Reiki at all. So, you know, if you have 15 minutes for your self-treatment in the morning, fine. If that 15 minutes turns out to be your usual self-treatment time and what you would like to do is more, then it means that your commitment to the practice is going to make sure that you either wake up earlier or that you decide that you're not going to take phone calls for until 9 o'clock in the morning or something so that you can have the time for your self-treatment. It's called discipline, practice, discipline. And so your treatment is doing it. And however long you do it is cool. So, yes, this is for self-treatment and treatment of others. I don't know what you meant, Smiles, about is this for self-Reiki as well?
Mm-hmm. Great.
Was that clear, Rachel, do you think?
I think it was very clear.
Okay, cool.
The next question that was submitted in advance came from Sherry. I hope I'm pronouncing your name right, Sherry. And you wrote, I was telling a friend about obtaining my Reiki degree through an online course. She kind of smirked and laughed. How do you feel about online Reiki training versus in-person training and attunements?
Ooh, tough question. Smiles, in my practice and in my understanding up until now, it is really important important for me to be with my students personally. And it is not about whether it works. That's not the issue. The issue for me is that there is something that is transmitted between these two people that I can't get in any other way. Like, I love our virtual community. I'm totally blown away how close I feel to you. When we do our Reiki together, I feel this pulsating that I know just fills the earth for me. But it's not the same as having you guys all in the same room, being able to hug each other. It's just not. And it never will be for me. I love this man, Eric Whitaker. He has these virtual choirs. Have you ever, I don't know if you've ever gone on YouTube. His name is Eric Whitaker, and he also has a couple of TED Talks. And he brought people from all over the world to sing these pieces. And they just, every time I listen to this, it moves me, just thinking about it, moves me to tears, because you get this intimate human connection that he brought out through this music and through their ability to be with each other, you know, and it's amazing. But that's not going to take the place of them being together in person. So that particular substance feels like I would miss that on an online Reiki training. Because I haven't experienced it, I have no idea if it works. I assume it does because you're here. And if you hadn't had value from your experience of an online Reiki training, then probably you would have just let it go. So I have to accept that piece, you know, as real, because I accept that our connection is real as well. It's just different. So 5 years ago, I wouldn't be able to be as ecumenical in my answer as I am today, because I've had so many online experiences in the last, especially 3 years, that I know that things can be transmitted. And of course, it's energy, so why can't it be transmitted? However, you know, I also don't, in my first degree classes, teach one or two people. Because, well, it isn't a rule, but it's a guideline, and I don't very often make exceptions to it. Because I want the people in the first degree class to actually have a class experience. Because I feel that this is a part of our Reiki experience, is to come together in community, in tribe, in groups, to experience this understanding. So I can empathize with your friend who smirked and laughed, although that's not very respectful for you. And if you can, and this is just me, I think it would be really great if you're the Reiki master who initiated you online, if they are teaching in-person class, if you could go to an in-person class and see if it feels different. It doesn't mean that you don't have Reiki. It's just, you know, having these two experiences side by side, I would be curious. And yeah, and if it's fine for you and you don't feel like there's something missing, then great, go for it.
Beautiful.
The next question we have is from Leela, who wrote, generally, how many symbols are taught in the first degree certification? And she also wrote, all you need four with a question mark.
Right. Well, Leela, this is a really easy question. There are no symbols taught in first degree in my form of practice. So that may not be true in other forms of practice, but in mine and in most of the ones that I know of, symbols come in the second degree. And I think I might have answered your all you need for. If you're online, I'd love it if you could clarify if you feel this has been answered. Thanks.
Great. Our next question is from Elena, who wrote, I am grateful to you for helping to get better and deeper understanding of Reiki. I agree that it's all we need for personal growth, ourselves and others who receive contact treatment only. As I was taught that it's impossible to do distant treatment with first degree, and only second degree allows us to do so. Because of the special symbol for distant healing, I am confused a bit because most of the time I feel energy flow in my hands and at the very beginning of the session, after pronouncing the name of the symbol, but I use the third degree symbol in any way as was taught by my master. I apologize, it looks like a lot of the words are cut off in what I was reading. I may have lost some of the words there. I don't know if you have all the words, Phyllis, to complete the question.
Actually, I think you did very well.
Great.
but I used the third symbol in any way as I was taught by my master. Could you please put some light on it?
Great.
Yeah. So, Elena, this brings up a wonderful question that I would love to do a webinar on, or at least an exploratory weekend at some point, because about 20 years ago, or maybe more, when we were trying to decide what about distant treatment and could first degree students actually treat someone that they weren't physically together with, we of course came up with a kind of workaround. We would call it now in the computer language a workaround. And there were a couple of them, and one of them was to use prayer. You know, prayer is not something that comes only from the Christian church. Prayer is something that humankind has used for ever since we were humans, to extend our wishes and to extend our energy into space and into someone else that's not physically with us. And so there is this wonderful question about prayer, and is prayer and the act of praying the same as practicing Reiki? I mean, is this prayer when we put our hands on? And if you look at it as a prayer, as this kind of ecumenical process of a human being, spiritual practice, and understanding of our oneness with each other, then I would say, yes, it is. It's something that just extends from us. So I know that many of you who have had many treatments given to you sometimes as I receive treatment, excuse me, I just automatically am lying there and I think of a friend of mine, for instance. And then I think, oh, is my state of being, as it connects to my friend's state of being, is my friend's state of being influenced by mine? I mean, it's a great question. So I just would like for you to know that what we do in first degree Reiki is not necessarily all that is, because I believe that there's understandings and things that are going on that we don't actually have any conscious way of connecting to. Human beings don't know much about the universe. You know, we only know from our own experience what is going on, and mostly that's not actually very accurate because we all have our filters and our biases and our resistances to having unlimited possibility. One of the other workarounds was to, if somebody really, really wanted to be with, so pay really attention to my word, to be with someone that they weren't physically able to be with, then I would say, take a photograph, put your hands on your photograph, and give it Reiki. And they found this very comforting and successful. So that's another possibility. I don't teach this in my class. It's not a part of my first degree at all, but it is something that a lot of people have come to just because of their own need. And sometimes that's how we learn about different ways to use it in different circumstances. Of course, you have energy flow in your hands. I'm not quite sure why this is confusing, because when I use the symbols in second degree or in first degree, when I walk into a hospital, my hands just start getting really hot, and it's because the energy is just flowing out of me, and that's normal. So I'm not sure why it's confusing. And if you need more to be said about that and you're online, please write it in the chat. Thanks.
Great. So, Phyllis, it's really interesting. It's something that I think about, if it's all right, I'd like to comment and see if you agree with this thought, line of thinking. So what I heard you saying is that some people just find new ways of being with Reiki through practice. It's what they need. It's what Reiki shows them, of like the example of giving Reiki to a photograph. And then what I imagine has occurred, like as we look at thinking about lineage, like you are the lineage bearer of Usui Shikiryoho.
Yes.
But then there are lots of different forms of practice that consider themselves also Usui Shikiryoho. And what I've always imagined is that it's that exactly of masters finding new ways to be with Reiki and then teaching that to their students. So there's like an honoring of what was given, but also an honoring of what's been revealed to them by Reiki in yes. their practice. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, to me, that feels very foundational in the practice itself. And I'm curious your thoughts on that.
On what exactly?
On like the shifting of the different forms of practice, uh-huh. but So, but if it's a foundation, even within the lineage of let Reiki teach you, something I've heard you say many times, if that's a foundation in the lineage, even these different forms are still expressions of the same practice, even if the practice is different because it's changed as Reiki has revealed itself in different ways through different masters.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So, yes, I think that might be true, but to satisfy our own human need for identification, I think it's easier to see them as, you know, different forms of practice. Because sometimes it's not the actual form, like but it's a philosophy or a principle that has been changed. And for me, then it's a really different form. I'll give you an example. So one of the first changes, one of the first major shifts of this practice that I carry was in, you know, the late 1980s, I think this came about, where all of a sudden, first degree and second degree were being taught in one weekend for a very a much less amount of money. And one of the principles of this, as I heard from the master, was I don't feel people need to have preparation for Reiki, that they can just have the tools, because they saw it as a technique. So they could give the person a tool, and then the person would learn how to use the tool as they progress. They would progress to the second degree. And that's actually how a lot of the students, you know, created their own time frame of taking first degree and second degree, is because they would, you know, do the first degree and then they would take on the second degree later. That quite often happened. So it wasn't just that it was a change of timing. It was really a change of philosophy. And for me, that's a new form. And it came maybe from, I don't know why actually it came, but it sometimes people thought, well, there's no reason to wait. But for our practice, there is a unspoken kind of understanding that preparation of the student is very important. And preparation is the time from when you decide to take the class, how you've raised the money, if you need to do that, or how you make time to take the class. And that is preparation time. But sometimes it's even more obvious, because sometimes in the early days, especially when there wasn't any other form of practice available, people would come and say to Hawaii Otakata, well, I don't want to pay $150 for first degree because it's too much money. And she would say, fine, you know, wait, save it up. Well, I can't do that. And she said, well, when it becomes important to you, you will. And it did. And if it wasn't, if it didn't become important to that student, it meant, or that person, it meant that Reiki wasn't really for them at the time. So there was a principle of preparation that was very important in this practice. And that's what's very interesting. So then on top of that happening, kind of human thing that happened, there was another thing that started happening in the late 1980s. And I did this myself. And I want to just excuse myself for a moment. I need to just...
Phyllis, when you're ready, you can re-show your video and audio.
Okay. When I began teaching and I began to have a lot of my own experiences of second degree, then in my second degree classes, I used to teach everything that I did in second degree because I thought it was what I was supposed to do as a master. And then what happened is that the masters during that period of time who took those second degree classes started to practice it as though it were their practice, but they couldn't relate to it because it wasn't really a part of their practice. And it was not their practice, it was a part of my practice. I don't know if this is confusing. So eventually I had to drop all of my own experiences out of the teaching part of my second degree class or my first degree class, so that they got this very beginner package. They got the tools with how to use it and what to do and the encouragement to go out and practice. And then what happened is that Reiki brought them their own gifts of discovery. And what I was doing is actually taking that from my students, that I was giving them all these different possibilities, and they didn't have any room to discover it themselves, which was so exciting for me as a student. So that part of teaching is very important to me when I prepare masters. I just say, you know, I want you to teach this basic class, and if people ask, oh, can you do this? You can say yes, but when it comes to you to do it, not as a part of your daily practice. And it may eventually become a part of their daily practice, or it may not. For instance, a colleague of mine, Paul Mitchell, when he took second degree, he was so connected with the process of giving yourself a mental emotional treatment that he started to do it every day in his self-treatment, and he's continued over the last 30 years doing that. And for me, I didn't connect with this treatment so much, and so I do it on occasion, but only when I decide that that's something that I want. So it really depends on, you know, each student having their own path and their own relationship with the practice. Did that answer your question? Rachel?
Yes. Yes. And I'll have to revisit it as well. in the recording, which I believe there is a recording happening.
I hope so.
Yeah. So we're coming close to our time.
Oh, yes.
And I'm wondering if there's a particular question you'd like me to read from that someone submitted in advance, or questions coming in on the live chat. How would you like to close?
I think let's go to Kate.
Okay, that's what I was thinking too. So Kate submitted a question in advance that sort of sums up this whole topic. And she said, what is the greatest benefit a person can receive from practicing first degree Reiki?
For me, the greatest benefit is to be aware, to be conscious of your connection with Reiki, the energy of life. You know, when you take a martial art, one of the principles of a martial art is not that you build up muscle power. Of course, you do get in shape because you're moving your muscles and your body all the time and you practice. But it's understanding that you as a human being have this connection automatically, but we aren't often conscious about it, to the energy of the universe. And when you are able, relaxed, and it takes relaxation, when you are relaxed and you're open and vulnerable and are able to connect with qi, or in Chinese, qi, then your own personal energy field is unlimited because you connected to the universe, which is unlimited. And so that's why masters of martial arts can do some phenomenal things, because they have practiced enough to be open enough and to be vulnerable enough to connect in and use universal life energy to seemingly flip somebody over without even touching them. And it's the same for us in Reiki, that it's our practice to become open and vulnerable and accept this energy of Reiki into our lives, so that, you know, when we think, oh, I just am in a corner, I don't know what to do with myself, I have no options, Reiki will bring you an option. And it'll bring an option that you would probably have never thought about. And often when I have that experience, I always go, well, like, why didn't I think about that first? But oftentimes it's so simple that it escapes me, because as human beings, we make things complicated. That's just one of those human things. So I really feel that as we connect to the energy of Reiki, our life opens up. And in one of these little articles that I wrote in like 1981 or 82, when I was first started, this was my experience of Reiki. And you can do this yourself when you get into, in English, we have this expression, when you work yourself into a corner, which means that you're facing a corner. So, you know, just literally do this sometime when you feel like you have no options. You know, like, just go to a corner of a room and stand in it and just get, okay, on this right-hand wall, I have this option, and on the left-hand wall, I have this option. And then I have the option in the center, which is, you know, maybe just to, depending on how intense the decision is, you know, maybe it's about life and death, actually, at that moment. And just be in that space and feel that helplessness. I mean, it's a terrible feeling. I don't like it myself. And then give yourself Reiki for a few minutes. And then just turn around. You have all the options in the world, in the universe. And so many options that sometimes you'd like only to have two options to choose from. And this is what Reiki gives you, gives us, gives me. And this is what has changed my life. Thanks.
Thank you. I'm going to try that in the corner. Have me tearing up a little bit.
All right.
Gratitude for Reiki. So we're going to close with just, I sort of actually went over a lot of what these announcements are of programs that we have coming up. So I think I'll just relist what they are. And this is unusual for us to have so many upcoming programs that we're talking about in one webinar, but we do have three different programs coming up that I want to make sure you at home and everywhere around the world are aware of. The first is our in-person global Reiki community gathering with the theme, We Are Sacred Earth. And it's going to be June 22nd to 25th in Michigan here in the United States. And it's a wonderful opportunity to come and be with us in person. We did made an intentional effort to keep the ticket price as low as we could. It's an investment of $500, which includes meals and lodging for all 3 nights and days of the event. And those of you who are with us live, you'll be getting an email about it. If this replay is on YouTube, then I'll include the link to all of these events and programs that I'm announcing in the description below. So just click there. The next opportunity that we have to engage is a program that Phyllis talked about during today's webinar called Healing Practice to Professional Practice, which is a 2-day online intensive, February 25th and 26th. We've got 4 full sessions, and it's an actual curriculum that Phyllis will facilitate and walk us through, leading us to imagine something that she referred to earlier as professional practice. It's this way of being Reiki in the world that that is not yet realized, but that many of us, and perhaps you, are interested in exploring and in realizing. And if that's you, if you are picturing Reiki in hospitals, Reiki in healthcare, perhaps if you've even begun doing that work or have interest in doing that work, this is a program for you. So Healing Practice to Professional Practice, look out for that link. I'll be sending an email to everyone, as well as posting in the Facebook group and posting a link below if you're watching on YouTube. The next opportunity to engage with us that's coming up is called Local Communities, Global Community. And it's this experience where Phyllis will be with a local community in San Francisco and broadcasting video. So we'll be seeing her teaching with the San Francisco community online, live. And yes, Phyllis. You're muted.
Sorry, that's not quite accurate. I'm not going to be teaching. We're going to have all the virtual people on a platform where everybody will be seen on a screen, and this will be projected onto a wall or a big screen. And so we will all be sitting in the room together, and you will be having conversation. And I will ask a question or give a little bit of a thing and then ask a question. And then you can talk together with the people in San Francisco or among yourselves virtually. It's like bringing the two together and having great conversation about what it's like to have Reiki in Brazil or Australia or Spain or San Francisco or wherever, and be able to hear all the different answers. So I'm very excited by it.
Yeah. So you'll be getting a link also to read information about that, see a short video of Phyllis talking about it, and you'll also be able to register. There are 2 options to register for that program. One is individual, the individual tuition. That's if you just want to be online, like I imagine you are right now. Skyping in, zooming in just your face, yourself. The tuition for individual registration is $126 US, and the tuition, sort of a group registration fee, if you would like to instead register once and then invite your local community to get together to participate. As well, there's a single registration fee for groups, and that's $250 US. And that's local community organizers. If you register a group, you're welcome to have participants share in that investment. And you're also encouraged, you're very free to be entrepreneurial in your organizing, if you want to organize a group and have Reiki share before or after the program or some supplemental program that you put on, you're organizing a group of people, and you're welcome to create it in a way that you also are compensated for your organizing efforts in that. So that's okay with us. And when you register for that program, you'll have an option to register as an individual or to register a group. And you would be the group organizer if you are the person registering. So that's all of our upcoming programs. And the other thing, which is a link that's actually shared for those of you who are on with us live, is these webinars, these Global Reiki webinars, are free. It's a public service that we do for the Global Reiki community, and it's our intention to keep these programs free. Some of you, you may wish to offer a gift, a monetary gift, of appreciation for these free programs. It's not expected, but absolutely appreciated. And you're welcome to do that by just sending a gift of any type, whatever you're called to ReikiWebinars@gmail.com through PayPal. So those are all of our announcements. I'm aware it's a lot, and I appreciate you sticking around and listening to all of them. And Phyllis, is there anything else you'd like to add?
Well, maybe it's time for us to connect in Reiki and yes. So let's everybody put our hands on, or if you have second degree or first degree and want to connect energetically without putting your hands on, that's also okay. I give thanks for the energy of Reiki. And for all the different paths and forms and directions that have brought us to this energy. Allowing us to develop and grow naturally into our authentic selves. Thank you. Thank you. And thanks for a great webinar. Thank you for all the questions. Of course, we will take as many of the questions as we can record off the chat, as well as the questions that we didn't get to today, and I'll put them on the webinar. And I apologize that I haven't had time. No, the Facebook page, sorry. I apologize that I haven't been able to get the December questions up yet, but I now have time and I will work on that as well. Take care, and I'll see you next time, whenever that is.
Bye. Peace, love, and Reiki, everyone. Thanks.